हाय फ्रेंड्स, गुड इवनिंग. वंस अगेन यू आर वेलकम टू नीट पीजी लाइव डेली. आई एम डॉक्टर प्रमोद शर्मा. सो हाउ इज लाइफ? मस्ट बी वेरी एंग्शियस बिकॉज यू नो द पीजी एंट्रेंसेस डेट्स आर नॉट टू फार एंड विद इन टू और थ्री मंथ्स यू विल बी स्टार्टेड यू विल बी हैविंग यू नो ऑल योर एंट्रेंस एग्जामिनेशन वन आफ्टर अनदर. सो इट्स अ हाई टाइम टू प्रिपेयर फॉर यू नो बी सीरियस. And there are always, you know, my good wishes are always with you. And I would, I believe that you guys are going to crack it. And so today we'll be discussing, you know, this gastrointestinal disorders, and in which I will be taking up today the diarrhea and constipation. Many of you must have experienced sometimes in your life an episode of constipation or diarrhea. How, you know, diarrhea is embarrassing and constipation, your entire days, you know, goes wasted. It becomes very lousy day when you are suffering from constipation. It does happen. It can happen to anybody. So today I will be discussing something which you will not get easily in, you know, textbooks. So the content of these presentations are exclusively taken from various books, and to make it, you know, most informative kind of session for you guys, because you deserve it. You are appearing for your entrance examinations, so you want that each and every question that comes from pharmacology should not be left unattended. So I have tried my best. I have tried to put, you know, the thumbnails, the videos, the animations wherever it is needed. And the content, I try to keep it crisp and, you know, informative. So as you all know that I am Dr. Pramod Sharma. I am a clinical pharmacologist by specialty. And you can, you know, join this group on Telegram app that gives you, you know, entire information about the daily activity that is to be conducted on An Academy Neet PG channel on YouTube. And you will be having all information well in advance that who is going to teach what. So you can always, you know, plan your day accordingly. So ye ek tarika hai aur aap is link ko click karke aap seedhe us jagah pe pahunch sakte hain jahan aapka koi bhi favorite educator class le raha ho aur aap us class ka anand le sakte hain. Theek hai, so ise download kar lijiye. Aur iske alawa aap log YouTube par to hain, mere lectures dekh rahe hain, mere live session dekh rahe hain. Agar aapko pasand aa rahe hain to main aapko bata dun aapki jankari ke liye ki YouTube pe to main aata hi hu. Ab main स्पेशल क्लासेस और प्लस क्लासेस तीनों प्लेटफॉर्म पे अवेलेबल हूँ. तो आपको मैं ये बता दूँ, यूट्यूब पर जैसे मैंने जीआईटी शुरू की है तो जीआईटी के टॉपिक्स ले रहा हूँ मैं, गैस्ट्रोइंटेस्टिनल डिसऑर्डर्स पढ़ा रहा हूँ मैं. और इसके नेक्स्ट डे जैसे कल मेरे बेटे का नीट एग्जाम है, सो आई विल नॉट बी अवेलेबल ऑन स्पेशल क्लासेस. सो अदरवाइज एक दिन मैं यूट्यूब पे आता हूँ, उसके नेक्स्ट डे मैं स्पेशल क्लासेस ले रहा हूँ. स्पेशल क्लासेस में आई एम टीचिंग यू नो दिस रेस्पिरेटरी सिस्टम. तो आप वहाँ आके भी मेरी क्लासेस का को लाइव देख सकते हैं, उसका फ़ायदा उठा सकते हैं. और उसके नेक्स्ट डे मैं पढ़ाता हूँ प्लस पे मैंने एंडोक्रिनोलॉजी चालू किया है. अभी एक ही टॉपिक हुआ है, वो भी आधा. तो आप लोग चाहें तो अगर मुझे आपको मेरी क्लासेस पसंद हैं तो आप इन तीनों प्लेटफॉर्म पर मुझे देख सकते हैं और मेरी क्लासेस से बेनिफिट उठा सकते हैं. लेकिन उसके लिए अनअकैडमी पर आपको आने के लिए लर्निंग ऐप डाउनलोड करना पड़ेगा ताकि आप स्पेशल क्लासेस देख सकें. और अगर और आप इंटरेस्टेड हैं तो आप प्लस का सब्सक्रिप्शन लेके प्लस की क्लासेस भी अटेंड कर सकते हैं, अगर आपको लगता है कि मेरी क्लासेस से आपको फ़ायदा होने वाला है. और मैं आपसे ये रिक्वेस्ट करता हूँ कि आप उन लोगों के साथ मेरे वीडियो ज़रूर शेयर कीजिए जिनको इनकी ज़रूरत है. आपको लगता है जो अफोर्ड नहीं कर सकते हैं, जिनको लगता है कि ये क्लासेस जो अगर मैं शेयर करूं अपने किसी दोस्त के साथ जिसे ये पता नहीं है और जिसको इसका फ़ायदा मिल सकता है, उसको ज़रूर शेयर कीजिए अपने दोस्त के हिसाब से, क्योंकि आपने किसी का फ़ायदा पहुंचाया इस तरह से. और आप स्पेशल क्लासेस में आपको बहुत सारा यू नो अनुभव और एक्सपीरियंस बिल्कुल वैसा होगा जैसे कि यू आर ऑन प्लस, So you actually can interact, and if you follow me, you can send me direct messages. I will take up your queries. I can answer your queries. I can clear your doubt on these special classes. It is very much similar to, plus that is paid subscription based application platform. So आप ये जरूर special classes जरूर attend करें अगर आपको सब कुछ पसंद आता है तो. और मैंने जैसा बताया कि अनअकैडमी प्लस पे बहुत सारी ऐसी चीज़ें हैं जो कि आपको एक्सक्लूसिवली प्लस पे मिलती हैं, तो आप सब्सक्राइब कर सकते हैं इस चैनल को और इस प्लेटफॉर्म को. और यहाँ पे सब्सक्राइब करने के लिए आपको यूज़ करना पड़ेगा मेरा कोड डॉक्टर प्रमोद. अगर आप मिस यू आर रियली इम्प्रेस्ड विथ माई टीचिंग द वे आई हैंडल यू नो क्वेरीज ऑन स्पेशल इन स्पेशल क्लासेज और प्लस. Or if you write me, I will definitely come back to you with the solution of your queries. And मेरी ये आपसे गुजारिश है कि आप जब भी ये नीट पी जी प्लस का सब्सक्रिप्शन लें, कम से कम 12 महीने के लिए जरूर लें, क्योंकि इन यू नो द 12 मंथ्स इज अ सफिशियंट पीरियड बिकॉज यू विल बी एक्सपोज टू मेनी न्यू एजुकेटर एंड दे विल कम विद यू नो न्यू न्यू कोर्सेज. सो यू विल बी एक्सपोज टू डिफरेंट कोर्सेज and that will give you a kind of feeling that and will make you a more better learner in terms of you know and you can be more competitive than your peers who are not attending or not taking any assistance of such learning platform. So I would request, so when you buy this subscription, buy it for at least 12 months and don't forget to apply my code. And other than that, the benefit, as I said, on available on Plus platform, that these live classes, during live classes, you can interact with the educator and you can ask your questions, your doubts, and everything will be taken care of right then and there. And this is why this is, you know, very interactive kind of platform where you are in touch with educator in real time. You can cast polls and you know you can see your position, how you're performing, your actual performance on the leaderboard and in comparison to your other friends or the other learners. So that will give that it gives an idea that where exactly you stand, what are the areas you have to you know improve upon. There are many test series, you can take up those test series that will strengthen your you know strengthen your confidence or your build up your confidence to face any challenges. Let it be any PG entrance, be it AIIMS or PGI or NEET PG, you can take up all those with confidence. So the more you take these test series and solve them and see their analysis and all that, that definitely improves your performance. And as I said, on Plus platform there is there are dedicated doubt clearing sessions after every three classes, and so that is a kind of you know icing on the cake. And this is a platform where you have to subscribe once only and you have unlimited access. You can see all the content offline, and moreover, the less the number of these students on Plus platform, it's a kind of you know privileged treatment to the student, because of the less number of the students, the educator can have can give individual attention to each and every student and make it sure that they are learning to their best of learning to best of their abilities. So I have discussed about all these things. I just asked one question. Any one of you or most of you in fact must have experienced an episode of constipation or diarrhea. These you know diarrhea constipation word looks very simple, but whenever a person faces you know this problem, he knows or she knows that how problematic the situation could be sometimes. So I thought both the you know diarrhea and constipation, both the things are equally important, but I thought of taking up constipation first, because you know constipation is a kind of thing where the things get slowed down. So I thought I will start slowly and then will reach to diarrhea. The moment is everything becomes very fast, and we need to go with a faster pace, like diarrhea. So this is my personal choice, and I could have taken diarrhea first also, but constipation I should I mean I thought of taking up constipation first. So if you ask me honestly, is there any perfect definition of constipation? So I would rather say there is no single agreed upon definition, generally agreed upon definition, because many people have defined it differently. Some says that less than 3 stools per week in female and less than 5 stools per week in a male with a high residue diet, or some people say that it is more than 3 days without a bowel movement. Some says straining at the stool, you need to put effort, I mean you have to push it hard, and most of the time is almost 25% of the time, or and or two or fewer stools per week. So they're quite big gross variation in the definition. So there is no single definition exist actually. So we need to rely on these information which is available in standard textbooks and vary as per on different books. So what should be the goals of therapy whenever you come across a patient suffering from constipation? The constipation may be chronic, may be acute, developed a few days back or within, and the approaches may be different. So usually goals of the therapy is to prevent constipation to get converted into chronic constipation, and this can be done by prevention by alteration of lifestyle, prevention of constipation, and usually lifestyle changes means dietary changes so that you do not fall trap to this constipation time and again. So you can prevent it by making dietary changes, because nowadays these junk food and all that are real culprit in causing this constipation and all. And for acute constipation, if a patient turns up with acute symptoms of acute constipation, the purpose here, the primary goal should be to relieve the symptoms and restore normal function by advising him how to take care of his bowel or her bowels. And yes, one should increase dietary fibers in diet by taking vegetables and fruits in by regularly including these things in your diet. Generous fluid intake, plenty of fluid intake should be ensured. Other than that, some exercise, and moreover is important. Most important is adjustment of bowel habits. Usually, we should give regular and adequate time to attend the urge for defecation. So what people do, they are not regular, they are very irregular in their habit, and all this because nowadays lifestyle is such that people don't have time for these routine, these रोजाना नित्य क्रिया के लिए लोगों के पास वक्त नहीं है. तो हमेशा यू अटेंड नेचर्स कॉल रेगुलरली एंड गिव एडिक्वेट टाइम, डोंट रश. So all these things are important in preventing constipation and on treating constipation as well. Moreover, if there is constipation secondary to some pathology, then correction of that underlying disease, that is important. And and more being as I am teaching you pharmacology, so wherever I talk, I would definitely talk about drugs. One should not ignore or should in fact elicit drug history, because there are group of drugs which can induce constipation. So that is more important. This one full slide is on drug causes, and there may be questions from that. And drug causes, one should always ask in drug history constipation, because it may be related to drug consumption of certain drugs. try to find out if a patient is taking a drug which is means can cause constipation. You try to use some alternative if it is available. If it is not possible, then try to reduce the dosage which the patient, the doses of the drug the patient is taking. If that is possible, try to reduce the doses, but without compromising the efficacy of the, you know, therapy. So there are several causes of constipation. Constipation can be because it's not simply a disease, rather it is a symptom of an underlying disease or a problem. Could be related to, I mean, problem elsewhere, but it is being manifested as constipation. For example, GI disorders, you see. It could be related to irritable bowel syndrome. We have, you know, diarrhea predominant and constipation predominant, diverticulitis, anal fissures. We can have, you know, hernia. We can have hemorrhoids. We can have ulcerative proctitis. We can have volvulus. We can have stenosis. We can have adhesions. Or we can have metabolic disorders or endocrine disorder, hypercalcemia, neuropathy because of diabetes or hypothyroidism, pregnancy, spinal cord injury, Parkinsonism, CNS tumors, various psychiatric disorders, inappropriate bowel habits, and drug induced, as I say, don't forget, whenever you are talking about pharmacology, that this part becomes more relevant. In fact, most relevant. This is all GI, I mean medicine, but I start the topic always with introduction and a little bit of information about the disease itself. So that becomes easier to understand the drugs, how these drugs can affect this disease process, how can it help in management of such a disorder. See, I will tell you how these drugs are causing with explanation so that you will remember that how these drugs can induce constipation. Analgesics. You know, inhibitor of prostaglandin synthesis. Prostaglandins are very important compounds in, you know, gastric motility. If you remember, I taught peptic ulcer, I said misoprostol, that was methyl, stable methyl analog of PGE1. So that was causing, what was the side effect of misoprostol? That was diarrhea. If you remember, abdominal cramps, that was because of the increased intestinal motility and all that. So if you block prostaglandin synthesis by using non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, what will happen? You may expect constipation. Opioids are very notorious for causing, you know, constipation. This is one of the side, because opiate being used for therapeutic purpose or those drug abusers, they remain chronically constipated and there is no tolerance developed to this constipating effect, you know. So opioids are very important, especially you know, you will be seeing patient, those who are being treated with this opiate compound for their, you know, ailment that requires opioid therapy, they are, you know, have facing constipation. Anticholinergic, any kind of anticholinergic drug, I talked about anti-muscarinic drug and all that, all have tendency to, because they all block anticholinergic action, and acetylcholine is most important, you know, most important you can say, but there are many other mediators are there, neurotransmitters are there in the peristalsis, involved in the peristalsis of the intestine, so that can cause, all anticholinergic can cause, you know, constipation. Antihistaminics, many antihistaminic has significant anticholinergic activity. Anti-Parkinsonian drug, those who can, means these are all anticholinergic drugs, so there is no specific anti-Parkinsonian drug, but these anticholinergic drugs, these all fall under anticholinergic. So benzotropin, triacetylphenidyl is especially used in Parkinsonism, and Parkinsonism itself is a cause of, you know, is associated with this constipation. So these anticholinergic can further complicate the picture. Phenothiazines used in, you know, this phenothiazines used in psychiatric disorder like schizophrenia, tricyclic antidepressant and depression. So please remember, all this antihistaminic, phenothiazine, tricyclic antidepressant, they do have significant anticholinergic activity. Many of their compounds have anticholinergic activity, so they all can cause constipation. Antacid, as I said, antacid, especially the calcium carbonate and the aluminium salts, I talked all this thing, you calcium carbonate, aluminium, you know, these all aluminium, I said this has astringent action, the aluminium phosphate that is being formed that leads to constipation, and you know, the aluminium itself, you know, aluminium phosphate is an insoluble compound, aluminium is a smooth muscle relaxant also, aluminium ion, so all these things can cause, you know, constipation. So we can try other agent which are, that is why with aluminium salt we are using magnesium salts in antacids, so because they cause diarrhea, so the effect is actually balanced. Barium salts can cause constipation, they are very they are known for because they are smooth muscle relaxant. Bariums also, calcium channel blocker, you know, calcium is essential for contraction of any muscle, they will let it be smooth muscles and all, so this calcium channel blocker will reduce the availability of the calcium in the cell, so that will also can cause, that will also cause, that will also lead to constipation. Clonidine is alpha 2 agonist, you know, alpha 2 present in the intestine, it actually inhibit the release of acetylcholine as a hetero inhibition kind of thing, so that can lead to, you know, constipation. Diuretics, especially non-potassium sparing, means more potent diuretics or more efficacious diuretics, especially the loop diuretics and thiazide diuretics, because they lead to increased urine excretion, so there is a kind of fluid deficit in the body, so because of less of fluid the stool become, you know, dry, so that can lead to constipation. Ganglionic blockade, so ganglionic blockade, let it be cholinergic ganglions, if they are blocked, that there will be blockade of the cholinergic transmission, so that will behave as an anti cholinergic drug kind of thing, so that will lead to, you know, iron preparation, iron can lead to diarrhea and you know, constipation both, so because of, you know, astringent action of the iron salts on the gastric intestinal mucosa, they can produce constipation. Muscle blockers, the succinylcholine, D-tubecurine, they can have, you know, ganglion blockade property, they block neuromuscular junction, but they can block ganglions also, so if parasympathetic ganglions are blocked, that can cause, you know, constipation. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, we have already discussed, these are all analgesic, as I said, prostaglandin synthase inhibitor, and this polystyrene sodium sulfonate is a drug which is used for reducing hyperkalemia, you know, and this can also lead to constipation, it is used in hyperkalemia. And the very important thing about this drug is whenever you take this drug, you need to need not lie down for at least 1 hour, you should keep standing or sitting, and this drug is also used off label in, you know, very important information, lithium toxicity. This is off-level of use of polystyrene sodium sulfonate. Otherwise, this polystyrene sodium sulfonate is used in hyperkalemia. And we are treating lithium toxicity. You should keep an eye on the serum potassium level. It may even lead to hypokalemia. So this is this one, you know, particular slide is important because I have explained the reason why this drug can cause constipation. So please remember all these things. And the one drug which comes to your mind whenever somebody is asking, opioids are the drug which cause constipation. This is very important, right? And the anticholinergic drugs. All opioids can cause constipation. All opioid compound can cause constipation, but it is the degree of constipation may vary between agent. It depends upon how the receptor selectivity, on what receptor they have predominant effect, and moreover their potency and all that. But this is very clear that if a drug is given orally, is more constipating than drug given parenterally. So these two facts you should remember, that the constipating effect varies among the different agents, opioid agents, compounds, and the orally administered drug is more constipating than the parenterally administered drug. This classification I have made as per the, you know, the effect, when we should expect the effect of these interventions and when they are used. So these are called first class of drugs are that cause stool softening only. They just soften the feces, and it takes time, 1 to 3 days. So in this category we have bulk forming agents, this methyl cellulose. this will remain largely unfermented because it is derived from the cell wall of the plant cells, but it is chemically treated to make methyl cellulose, and it is an insoluble fiber, and this increases these are hydrophilic substances, they draw water and swell. Polycarbophyll is a synthetic polymer of polyacrylic acid. These are synthetic fibers. Psyllium is, Isabgol, many of you must have seen this Isabgol or Spagula husk. Dietary fibers are, bran is whatever we, when you use this wheat flour and all that. So when you, coating of the wheat actually, that remains there, that is called choker or bhusi. That is called bran. So these dietary fibers, this bran, these are all bulk forming agents. Emollients, if used, you'll see when you we talk about skin problems, then there comes the role of emollients. They just hydrate the skin and all that. So we have docoset sodium, dioctrinyl sodium sulfonate, and lactulose is very much available in the market, and you must have seen it is very commonly used in hospital setting, and the mineral oil, that is liquid paraffin. So these are all bulk forming agent, and they are usually stool softener, and they take time actually to show their action and can take 1 to 3 days. So another group of agents are the drugs which actually can soften the stool, as well as can produce semi-fluid stool, and the time duration is little shorter, that is 6 to 12 hours. So they are more potent and more efficacious, laxatives, and the agents included under this category are Bisacodyl. Bisacodyl, this is available as Dulcolax. So this can be given orally, as well as suppositories are available. So this is the oral, and suppositories are here. Suppository has more prominent or more pronounced action on all that. Senna we have, it is derived from certain pods of certain plant. Magnesium sulfate in low doses, though it is a saline purgative, but in low doses it act as just produces stool softening or semi-fluid stool in 6 to 2 hours, but at higher doses it can become. So that is why for many laxatives, if they are used in lower doses, they are called either laxative or aperients, but at same compound at higher doses become purgative or cathartic. So depending upon the doses used, the effect may vary. And these are the most potent agent or most efficacious agent, you can say. They can result in watery evacuation, and the time of onset may be as low as 1 to 6 hours. They may can cause GI evacuation within 1 hour, or can extend up to 6 hours. So we have various salts like magnesium citrate, magnesium hydroxide, magnesium sulfate, but in higher doses. Lower doses is just, it takes more time, it is less efficacious than this. Sodium phosphate and Bisacodyl, this suppository which is used rectally, then it can cause watery evacuation. And this polyethylene glycol is very much popular for gastrointestinal or bowel whole bowel irrigation, for colon cleansing. So this polyethylene glycol is in an electrolyte preparation, it is very popular in bowel wash. So let us start with bulk forming agent. Listen carefully, everything is important, because I have kept every statement that is really important, because whenever you download these slides, you should have information. You don't have to go for watch video and all that, because it takes time to watch entire video. So the slides are such that they contain that much information by which you can revise that topic at least. So these bulk forming agent, the name itself suggests, they form the bulk, they increases the bulk of something, and here we need to increase the bulk of the stool. So because they are more hydrophilic in nature, they absorb water. So what will happen? They increases the water content of the feces. And I said there must be, you know, adequate water intake and all that, so that you do not develop constipation. So this is what we are doing. These substances actually absorb water and increases the water content of the feces. So what happens? The feces swells up, it gets softened, and this actually facilitate colonic transit. So it is not stuck at one place, it keeps moving and you do not develop constipation. Not only that, these, you know, bulk forming agents, these agents are acted upon by the colonic bacteria. There are bacterial population, so they convert it into many osmotically active products. Osmosis, you know, osmotic active product, what they can do? They can draw water from the cells in the lumen of the intestine. So that will lead to availability of the more water, and that will again will increase the content of the water content of the feces, and this all leads to, you know, softening of the stool. Fibers supports bacterial growth. Why these fibers are important? Because these fibers support bacterial growth in the colon, and this, you know, when bacterial growth, a certain fraction of the total fecal mass is made up of bacteria, so they contribute to total fecal mass. So more is the mass, that will lead to, you know, stretching, distension of the, you know, intestine, and that will facilitate peristalsis. In fact, because of there are stretch receptors in the wall of the intestine, bulk forming agents are considered as first line approach. If anybody talks about what should be initiated first, so for simple constipation, not complicated constipation that is related to a secondary to some other cause, that is a different issue. The first line approach is for simple constipation is bulk forming agent. And not only that, there are situations or condition or circumstances where you need to avoid straining at the time of passing stool, so that time these, you know, stool softener can work. These are bulk forming agent, they soften the stool, so they pass easily without much, you know, effort. So this is important in case where you have undergone rectal surgery, ocular surgery, or, you know, you are having surgery and all that, and you are suppose having post MI period. So pushing a lot can cause, you know, increase heart rate and all that, that can further increase the, you know, oxygen requirement of the heart, cardiac work will be increased, so that may precipitate another attack. So all these situations where actually straining is to be avoided, fresh post operatively fresh wound is there, the stitches might, you know, break, and the wound dehiscence may be can happen. So these kind of things, to avoid strainings, we usually give, you know, these bulk forming agent there, because they soften the stool and makes it the stool passes very smoothly without much effort. If you remember, you all have doctors, you have all done your internship. If you know that that in hospital many patient must be having, you know, must be taking that lactulose is a very common, you know, laxative that is being prescribed for hospitalized patients to prevent constipation, because those are bedridden patients, they are not having much activity and all that, so they are more likely to develop a constipation, you know. So that is to be avoided by, and you could have seen that lactulose bottle there with those patients, those are admitted in the hospital. These bulk forming agent, one thing should be very clear that if you do not take plenty of water with these bulk forming agent, these are not going to work, because they need water. Because once the water is there, then only they will, you know, imbibe that water, swells up and soften the stool. If you do not take plenty of water and you are using bulk forming agent, they are not going to help you. So this is a mandatory. And full effect of, don't be hasty, because I already said they take 1 to 3 days of time. So full effect takes time. So to take them on daily basis for at least 3 to 4 days before you can realize their benefit. Okay. And these agents are usually used in the prevention. prophylaxis of the constipation. This cannot soften the feces which is already present. So this is useful only in the prevention of the constipation, and it cannot treat with the already established constipation. Remember it. This will not happen. So this is only for prevention of constipation. That is why I say in hospital there is usually laxative started, because they are more likely to develop constipation because of their restricted activity and all that. Flatulence is an issue with them, because these are all fibers, and bacterial action on that can lead to formation of gas and all that. So flatulence is an issue, and it should be therefore avoided. It should be avoided. Please listen carefully. When there is gas distension, to where it should be avoided? You can simply answer this: when there is GI ulcerations. If ulcerations are there, the wall of the intestine is weak there. If there is excessive gas formation, there could be perforation. So avoid that. If there is adhesions, there are stenosis, or if there's possibility of fecal impaction. So in such cases, please don't prescribe bulk forming agents. And one most important thing, don't forget, again I am reiterating, plenty of water with these agents is the only solution. Otherwise, despite taking these drugs, you will not be benefited. You are not going to derive any benefit. And wait for some time. It takes time. And this is only preventive therapy. It is not definitive therapy. It does not treat established constipation. Emollient laxative, the most important compound in this group is docoset sodium, and as I said, dioctyl sodium succinate or sodium sulfonate, sorry. So docoset sodium is an anionic detergent. Its major mechanism of action is that it is a detergent, in fact. And it softens the stool by, increasing the total accumulation of the water within the stool. All are acting on the same principle. All are increasing the water content of the stool, so that its mass increases, its total, stool weight increases, all that. Because it is a detergent, this has emulsifying action. Emulsifiers are those compounds which can allow mixing of aqueous phase with lipid phase. So this emulsify the colonic contents. So what happens, there is better mixing of the aqueous as well as fatty contents, and because of that there is increased penetration of the water within the stool. Otherwise what will happen, the oil will prevent entry of the water, because both are actually repel each other, they do not mix. But emulsifier is a mediator in between them, and that it allow mixing of both the contents, so that will lead to entry of the water in the stool. So increased accumulation of water in the stool, for the more in penetration. But because this is a detergent, it can disrupt or can damage the mucosal barrier. It can lead to damage to the intestinal mucosa. So if barrier is breached, what will happen? It will allow absorption of substances that are maybe naturally not absorbed. So never give liquid paraffin with docoset sodium, considering that mixing two drugs will have better effect. That way you may land up in problem, so avoid liquid paraffin, because liquid paraffin will be absorbed. Otherwise liquid paraffin is usually not absorbed from the intestine. As I said, these all fall under the these agents which actually causes bulk forming agents. So they take time. So this is to be used for 1 to 3 days, and it is a preventive therapy for constipation. As I said, this cannot help in a patient who have already developed constipation. Same indication that straining, if it is to be avoided, then you need to give this bulk forming agent that can soften the stool, and it is unlikely to be effective if other causative factors are not attended. Suppose it is because of some underlying pathology that is not corrected, or you know your fiber intake you have not increased in your diet, or suppose you are taking certain drug which induce which are in certain drugs which are inducing constipation that are not taken care of, either they are not stopped or are not substituted with some alternatives or like that. So if those factors are remains unattended, then this is unlikely to be effective. So one should take care of those as well to make the therapy act at best. Lubrication, you know, lubrication, for lubrication what we use oil for lubricating any machine, any part. What do we do, lubricant, we all use cycle, motorcycle, car, everywhere lubricants are very commonly used. So this liquid paraffin is also a petroleum product, I think, and this actually is being used in constipation, because it is pharmacologically inert, not absorbed. That is why we are using it, because we take it by mouth and it goes out through anus, so there is no problem, and it is inert, so does not react with anything. So what is the advantage? Because this is for lubrication and it lubricates stool. You can see it forms a coating around the stool, so it becomes more slippery. You understand? So it reduces the friction. So it allows an easier passage. If you apply oil at some place on the floor and you put your foot there, you will slip. So there is slipping of this stool. This means, you know, it allows easier passage. If you take this for 2-3 days on regular basis, and because it is oil, as I said, there the emulsifier was allowing aqueous and fatty content to mix up easily with Docaset, but this being an oily nature, it will prevent colonic absorption of water. That is good, because it promotes or it retain water in the colon, and that water will ultimately will get into the stool, and the content or the weight of the stool will increase. So this is laxative, which can be used similarly for other stool or bulk forming agent, just to avoid straining. And sometimes the problem is, as I said, it can be absorbed systemically, and if it is absorbed, then this being a foreign body, you can produce foreign body reaction in lymphoid tissues, like it can be absorbed through, because it is a lipid, it will be absorbed through lymphatics, so it will reach to lymphoid tissues like spleen, liver. It can produce foreign body reaction in the mesenteric lymph nodes, on the submucosal lymph nodes, and all that submucosal lymphoid tissues. So this is the problem. If it is absorbed somehow, then it can lead to such reactions. Also, because it is oily in nature, and if you use it for bedridden, debilitating, recumbent patient, and what happens, we usually give the medicine for a bedridden patient, just ask them to just support them to with the hand, and just at the 45 angle we give the drug and whatever, because they cannot sit because they are so sick. So if this is given, it can sometimes lead to aspiration on those debilitating old recumbent bedridden patients. So there is risk of lipoid pneumonia also, lipid pneumonia that is called. So this is to be taken into account while you are giving this. The patient should be sitting properly, and there should be no deficiency of reflexes, otherwise this can lead to aspiration of this product in the respiratory tract and can have consequences. It is very bland in taste but very unpleasant also. So this is also one of the reason for unpalatability or unacceptability of this particular laxative. People don't like it, and because this is a fat and this is not, it is pharmacologically inert, so many fat soluble vitamin will get dissolved into it and will not be absorbed at all. So this can lead to long term deficiency of fat soluble vitamins. So this should be taken into consideration while we are using this particular drug for long time. And many a time, because this is oil, your anal sphincter cannot hold it sometimes, and it can get leaked out of the sphincter and can soil your clothes, and that can become a subject of embarrassment, social embarrassment. So this could be socially embarrassing many a times. So this is liquid paraffin is it is being used, but less commonly and preferred less by the patients. Lactulose, I said you will see this medicine most often in clinical practice, which is used. It's nothing, it is a semi-synthetic disaccharide, means it consists of galactose and the fructose. And this disaccharide is neither digested nor absorbed. That is the reason why it actually retains water. If it is digested and absorbed, then it will not work. If nothing is left in the intestine, who will retain water? Nothing. So it remains there and it retains water, gets swelled up. And it is actually a osmotic diuretic, right? But kept under, because its action takes time and its action is more, I mean, less pronounced. It forms soft stool, so that is why it is kept under the category of stool softener. Otherwise, it is a osmotic diuretic, and osmotic or saline diuretics are very, they are capable of producing liquid, means stool. But it acts as a stool softener, and it is acted upon by colonic bacteria, this disaccharide, and produces more active products. And those products are usually acidic, lactic acid, acetic acid, formic acid. They all are active actually. So the more this, because of more and more formation of acids from this, that leads to increase, osmosis, because tonicity increases, so that can draw water from the surrounding tissues as well. So this drug act actually as stool softener when it is used at low doses, because it has indication in different conditions also, where the larger doses are being used, and that serve different purpose. This, at low doses means 10 gram twice daily with plenty of water. As I said, plenty of water is always required wherever you are using stool softener. Without that, your efficacy of these medications will be doubtful. As I was saying, that lactulose, other than this stool softener action, it has other action also, and that is quite important, because it is used in hepatic encephalopathy, and it can reduce this. Hepatic encephalopathy is because of the increased ammonia production and increased concentration of ammonia in the brain that has CNS depressant effect. So this hepatic encephalopathy, it can reduce blood ammonia concentration by almost 50%. And how it is possible? As I said, it is converted into many osmotically active products which are acidic in nature, formic acid, acetic acid, lactic acid. So there is increase, the stool pH of the stool decreases, it becomes acidic. So this ammonia is produced by bacteria in the intestine. They are ammonia producing bacteria actually. Because of urease activity, they produce ammonia. And this ammonia, when this compound, this lactulose, is broken down into many acidic components or acidic active products. So because ammonia become ionized into ammonium salt, because more and more hydrogen ions are present there, so this ammonia, being a base, can bind to that hydrogen ion and becomes an ammonium salt. I means ammonium ion. So this ammonium ion, because this is ionized, it will not cross blood membrane and all that. So this ammonium ion is actually excreted in the urine, and it does not actually reaches to the brain or enhances the symptoms of encephalopathy. So please remember that this ammonia to ammonium ion, that is ionized moiety never crosses the lipid cell membrane. But the this is how it affects in it has you know role in hepatic encephalopathy. But this is costly, this is expensive, lactulose is expensive, so this cannot be considered as a first choice drug in case of simple constipation. I'm not talking about hepatic encephalopathy, simple constipation, because this milk of magnesia, that is 8% suspension of magnesium hydroxide, is as effective as this compound, this lactulose, and is cheaper as well. But this this particular lactulose can be considered means first choice, especially in elderly, those with acute constipation. But it can cause flatulence, it can cause diarrhea, it can cause this electrolyte disturbances as well, and nausea, because it is very sweet in taste, so it can produce nausea in many patients. This can be nauseating, being very sweet. So other than that, if it, some of it may be absorbed, so the diabetic should be very little cautious about the use of this lactulose. However, it is usually not absorbed, but if some of it, very small quantity, may be absorbed, so this could be problematic. That can affect sugar level in diabetics, as well as it is to be avoided in patient of galactosemia, because it contains galactose. So so any galactose containing food is meal or diet is restricted in galactosemic patients, so this is to be avoided in galactosemic patients. Glycerin, have you ever heard that glycerin is being used as you will find it in very few textbooks. Glycerin is a very good laxative, and is useful, and particularly in children, it can be given as a suppository, and in those children who are actually experience the episode of intermittent constipation, it is particularly useful in them. It can be given by suppository, and it acts through osmotic action. And if it is suppository is applied, it can produce action within 30 minutes. So it is very good, and usually is non-irritant, but sometime it can cause rectal irritation. Otherwise, it is considered as very safe. That is why it is used in children. And this is should be a drug of choice in children, particularly those develop intermittent constipation. They have tendency of avoiding nature's coil or urge to defecate. They are either busy in playing, or they have irregular lifestyle kind of thing. Some children, they are more prone to develop, and they are very what do we say, addicted to junk food and all that. Do not take adequate fiber, do not eat vegetables, do not take enough fruits and all that. So these children, some children are very prone to develop constipation. So glycerin could be a solution to such people, such children actually. Now we come to saline purgative, saline or osmotic purgative. All these ions or salts, magnesium sulfate, phosphate, citrate, these are all non-absorbable ions actually, and they act by osmosis. Non-absorbable, that is why they remain, they are retained in the intestinal lumens, and they increase tonicity of the luminal fluid. So they draw water from the surrounding tissues. So they act by osmosis. So they increase gastrointestinal fluid volume, and that ultimately that increases causes distension of the bowel. And there are stretch receptors. If bowel is distended, those stretch receptors are stimulated, and that can indirectly enhance peristalsis. So they are increasing peristalsis. Moreover, this magnesium ion is known to cause cholecystokinin release, and this cholecystokinin itself has action like purgative kind of action. So this can add to the action of these magnesium ions. And these saline purgatives are available for both oral use as well as for cleaning the bowel. They can be given rectally also, and they have quick onset of action. As I said, this saline purgative in the category where the duration of onset of action is within 1 to 6 hours. If they are giving through rectal route, they can cause evacuation within an hour. And if you give it orally, it can take 1 to 6 hours. And they can produce totally watery evacuation. And they are primarily used in condition where the acute evacuation of the bowel is required. For example, for diagnostic examination, some diagnostic radiological examination, all that. For that, you need a clean GIT or clean bowel so that radiographic pictures are more appreciable or more clear. And after poisoning, so this actually can cause removal of the poison through the through feces of the unabsorbed portion of the poison. If it is already absorbed, there is no point in giving purgatives and all that. But if it is unabsorbed, that can lead to rapid removal of the poison through the in the feces. So this is also can be used in poisoning with certain drugs and with some antihelminthic drugs to remove protozoa, that is called purging, that is used for purging. Because after using antihelminthic drugs, so suppose these parasites are paralyzed or either killed, so they can be removed from the body by giving these saline purgatives. This leads to purging, so that reduces the effective load of these parasites in the intestine and all. So they are usually used in acute situation or conditions where you need early evacuation of the bowel. So they act very fast. If you give it by rectal route, they can act within an hour. These drugs are kept for acute use. But this milk of magnesia is, as I said, 8% of suspension of magnesium hydroxide. This is used occasionally. You can use it for any otherwise healthy adult who develops constipation off and on. So every few weeks, if you are developing some kind of problem, you can use it off and on. So this milk of magnesium is considered as safe and not very costly. Also, I think this is available as Cremafin. So many of the healthy adults, those who are on traveling jobs most of the time, so they develop because of their no dietary proper dietary intake or not healthy diet they are taking, and their activity is very haphazard, so irregular during travel and all that, so they might develop constipation off and on. So for such people, this kind of treatment may be required. So this saline purgative, as I said, and here I am using the term cathartics. As I said, the laxative or aperients are the action which is of lesser intensity, but cathartic and purgatives are higher intensity action, more liquid evacuation of the fluid or watery evacuation. So they are not there for routine treatment of the constipation, but they can be used if that constipation is really difficult to treat, so might work. But for routine treatment, they are not used because they can lead to acid-base balance disorder and electrolyte disturbances. As I said, rectally, if you use them, so they are used as enema for evacuation of the bowel on urgent basis. And these drugs can cause problem. These ions can cause problem because if sodium salts are used, they can lead to extra sodium load in the body that can accentuate the exacerbate the CHF, and magnesium ion should be avoided in case of chronic kidney disease or a renal impairment. So we have discussed lot many agents. You should be knowing that which category of drug I should use in patients. So for the prevention of, as I said, for prevention of the constipation, the bulk forming agents are very important, and they should be used for at least 3 days, and adequate water intake should be ensured, then otherwise they will not act. and other drugs which I talked, you know, bisacodyl, that is orally given, senna and magnesium sulfate in low dose, that all can cause semi-solid or softening or semi-solid stool. 6 to 12 hours means you take at night and in the morning you have, you know, bowel movement that clears everything. So that way you can use such agents, but those which are stronger one and the third category are not for routine use. But patient with chronic idiopathic constipation, for which the reason is not known, there are several agents available other than those, and I will be discussing those. This lactitol is a very new compound. It is, I think, in this year only, February, approved by US FDA. This is also a disaccharide, like and to be avoided in galactosemia. And this lactitol is also osmotic laxative like lactulose, and this leads to influx of water in the small intestine, and that leads to laxative action in colon, because the osmotic laxatives, they draw water from the surrounding tissues, and that increases you can cause distension of the intestinal wall and all that. So this drug is particularly indicated for CIC. CIC is chronic idiopathic constipation, because constipation may be secondary to some cause, so they can be corrected by treating or addressing the primary cause. But this is idiopathic, you do not know, and that is all because dietary habits, lifestyle and all that. So this is actually given in doses of 20 milligram per day, and it is quite effective. And many time it happens that the patient is having persistent loose stool because of lactitol, dose may have to be decreased to 10 milligram. And any purgative or laxative, it is true for everything that you should not use these stronger laxatives or purgatives whenever you suspect any mechanical GI obstruction, because this will create problem. So this is applicable for almost every compounds, because they will enhance obstruction, further obstruction, and might lead to rupture of the intestine, because if there is a mechanical obstruction because of some tumors or something else, or maybe because of the bunch of parasites like nematodes or something can produce mechanical obstruction. So unless the primary cause is attended or addressed, they should not be used. There should be one should rule out the secondary cause of the constipation, and so should be avoided in GI obstruction, galactosemia. As I said, lactitol also contain galactose, and this drug can interfere with the absorption of other medications. So one should avoid giving other medications 2 hours before and 2 hours after giving this medication, lactitol. So it should be used at such a time when, or you can plan accordingly the administration of other drugs, so that a fair 2 hour difference can be maintained between two. Okay, another category of drugs are stimulant or irritant purgatives, which I was discussing under the category causing semi-solid stool or softening within 6 to 12 hours. So these drugs are also very commonly used stimulant purgative, bisacodyl, I think Dulcolax, that ad is also there on the TV, I think. So this Dulcolax is it is available as a suppository or the tablet also. It depends, doses depends upon the degree of constipation and all that. It is available from 5 milligram to 15 milligram or something like that. So it's stimulate GI motility, they are stimulant, I am saying, and or irritant. So they see their effect, they are categorized as based on their action. So they stimulate GI motility indirectly by causing irritation, or directly by acting on the mantric plexus. Mantric plexus is there, submucosal plexus, orbic plexus there, mantric plexus there. So they stimulate mantric plexus, which is involved in the motility of the gut. So they cause it indirectly as well as directly, and their major action is in the colon, where they alter absorptive and secretive activity. So that ultimately leads to retention of the fluid in the intestinal or colonic lumen, and that is how it can lead to stretching and all that, and that ultimately leads promotes to further, you know, leads to increased motility and evacuation of the bowel. But they are affecting the absorptive and secretory activities, so larger doses and chronic use. That is why we say and purgative abuse is, it's a word actually, like drug abuse, you know, this is purgative abuse. Abuse does not mean that you are using illicit substances. Abuse, I already told you, I think you or in general pharmacology, abuse means if you are using any drugs that deviate from the actually labeling information or as per advice of the doctor. Suppose you have been said that you can take it for 7 days, don't take more than that, but otherwise it can cause problem, but you are taking it for indefinite period, so this becomes abuse. In fact, drug abuse, saline, this purgative abuse, because you are using it, because without this you are not addressing other issues before, because of which you are suffering from you know, constipation, but you find it easier to take a purgative and you know, make your life happy. So that actually you are using despite the instruction of the prescriber that don't use it for more than 7 days, despite knowing the side effects associated with them. So this becomes abuse. So this analgesic abuse, this purgative abuse, the hypnotic abuse, the doctor, because you are having temporary insomnia because of some reason, some you know, some you know, emotion, some event in your house that led to your loss of your dear one or your father, mother, so you are not you know, that you are emotionally so disturbed that you cannot sleep. So one can prescribe in drug for induction of sleep for and ask you to take it for 7 days only, or whenever you feel that you are not able to sleep, then only you take it. But you become addicted to that and you take them indefinitely, or whenever you like you use them. So this is called you know, hypnotic abuse. So abuse does not mean the illicit substance you are using. Any substance, any drug, if you are using it and pattern and dosage which you are using deviates from the normal, you know, labeling or prescribing information or the pattern of use in the society. So this larger doses and chronic use can cause fluid and electrolyte imbalance, because you know, it all draws water from the fluid from the, you know, surrounding tissues, so it can affect systemic circulation, may be affected. So it can be, it should be, because of its irritant action and all that, this it should be avoided in pregnancy, because it can reflexly stimulate you know, gravity uterus, so that can lead to threatened abortion and all that. So it should be avoided. And it can, as I said, intestinal obstruction, any kind of obstruction, it is because they are little more in intensity, is little more their action of intensity of action. That is why this obstruction, chronic, subacute, acute, any kind of, should be ruled out before using, you know, these compound. This bisacodyl is a good example of this irritant or stimulant purgative. This is, as such, is not active, and in the small intestine it is activated by deacetylation, and then it reaches to the colon where it irritates colonic mucosa and produces mild inflammation and secretion. So you know, where the, whenever there is inflammation, all that, there is leading, there is production of prostaglandins, all that, so that produces secretion and all that, so that it acts by that way also. So this can be used orally and rectally. So if you use it orally, you can, you know, you, then it falls under the second category, that duration of onset of action within 6 to 12 hours. And when you use it rectally as a, you know, suppository 10 milligram, it produces watery stool within 1 to 6 hours. So the intensity of action is higher when you use it rectally. And it is useful in children, especially more than 6 years. It is not approved for children more less than 6 years, because it, if suppository is applied, it can be given as tablet or suppository, but usually suppository is used in children, and it can be a good you know, alternative in children. Senna is another you know, drug in the second category of the, you know, laxative, that is duration of onset of action within 6 to 12 hours. This is obtained from leaves and pod of Senna plant, that is, I think, this Acacia species, some Acacia species. नॉट अकेशिया, केशिया स्पेसिस, दैट इज केशिया फिस्टुला एंड ऑल दिस. आई थिंक हिंदी में अमलतास बोलते हैं, उसके पीले फूल भी होते हैं येलो कलर के, बहुत प्यारे लगते हैं. और उसके बड़ी बड़ी पॉट्स होती हैं, फलियाँ होती हैं ऑलमोस्ट एक एक डेढ़ डेढ़ फिट लंबी, यू मस्ट हैव सीन दैट. सो दीज एक्चुअली लीव्स एंड पॉट कंटेन्स एंथ्राक्विनोलोन ग्लाइकोसाइड. ये ग्लाइकोसाइड एज सच तो एक्टिव नहीं है, दे आर नॉट एक्टिव, बट दिस ग्लाइकोसाइड आर ऑल्सो नॉट एब्जॉर्ब इन द स्मॉल इंटेस्टाइन, एंड यहाँ एब्जॉर्ब नहीं होकर ये पहुँचते हैं इन कोलन. कोलन में जाने के बाद क्या होता है, द बैक्टीरिया एक्चुअली एक्ट अपॉन दीज ग्लाइकोसाइड्स एंड देन लिबरेट एक्टिव एंथ्रानॉल डेरिवेटिव्स. दिस एंथ्रानॉल इज एक्चुअली एक्टिव एंड विच कैन एक्ट लोकली एज वेल एज इट इज एब्जॉर्ब इन टू द सर्कुलेशन. And action is same as, you know, bisacodyl. It also takes, 6 to 8 hours to act. But one thing is that this drug is secreted in the mother's milk. So it should be avoided in women who are nursing their babies because it can produce diarrhea in suckling infants. See, one of the drug is avoided in pregnancy, the bisacodyl, because this can lead to reflex contraction of the gravid uterus. And this, senna is to be avoided in lactating women because this can produce diarrhea in suckling infant. But this drug, very surprising. But this drug, senna, should not be used in lactating women because through milk it can reach to the suckling infant and can produce diarrhea. But a child more than 1 year of age is suffering from, constipation, the same drug can be used in those children. It is safe in them. Got my point? So, I have brought or incorporated information from many places that you give you, that gives you, overall information. This, whatever information is available on laxative and purgatives, I have just incorporated that so that you do not miss out on any question. You should be able to answer each and everything. So if you want to have a cursory look on these PowerPoint presentation, you can go through that. That will be very easy to revise, but many a time to understand, because it is not possible to put everything in the slide and I need to explain it verbally. So you can listen to those lectures, then everything will be crystal clear for you. You will be able to answer each and every question. That much I can assure you. And this is my effort. My endeavors are always to make you feed you with so much of information that even if any question comes, you should be able to understand. Yes, this was touched upon by Dr. Pramod somewhere in some class. You should not be blank, in fact. Right? This PEG electrolyte solution costly, but as I said, this has become very popular in whole bowel irrigation and for colon cleansing, and especially required when you are doing surgery on colorectal area or colorectal zone, and also for diagnostic procedures. So this is important, and it may be required that, but it is an electrolyte solution because it is being used in 4 liter solution over 3 hours, can produce severe electrolyte disturbances. That is why it is an electrolyte solution. It have many ions and all that, so that this electrolyte balance is not disturbed in the body. And this is not for routine treatment of constipation, especially as I said, this is for diagnostic procedure or colorectal surgery wagera. And avoided in intestinal obstruction, that is true for almost all agents, because this can lead to problem. Now I will be talking about drug very specific, having unique mechanism of action, and they have made appearance in the recent years to handle the situations which are beyond constipation, and they act by a unique mechanism of action, and all these drugs can be a question in your coming entrance examinations, either their mechanism, what is the target of this drug, or the target is mentioned, which is the drug which acts through this, and their any where actually what is the indication, what are the important side effects, everything. Means these drugs now I'm going to talk are you know, having unique mechanism of action, and they are used in situations where other drugs cannot work. So the Lubiprostone is a chloride channel activator, and this chloride channel is chloride channel 2, and this channel is very unique. It is a channel, but these channels are voltage gated, right? And they have two ports because they actually dimerize. When the lubiprostone activate this channel, they dimerize, so they form dimers. So each channel activator, they become dimers, so one unit. So there are two pores. So they act locally and enhance chloride rich intestinal fluid secretion. You know, this is causing secretion, intestinal fluid secretion. And this is, you can see, it is a PG1, derived from PG1, which is an agonist for EP4 receptors, and it acts through increasing cyclic AMP level. Protein kinase A formation. So this all fluid secretion and everything is, despite it is structurally related to PG1, which is an EP4 agonist, but it is interacting with chloride channel 2 actually, and promoting chloride rich fluid secretion, and that is not or independent of the activity of the protein kinase A or this cyclic AMP or all that. That is why, you know, and they do not also affect the serum sodium or potassium level also, but prostaglandins can. So this leads to, you know, because of this chloride channel activation, this leads to efflux of chloride in the intestinal lumen. Now this is negatively charged chloride, more and more negatively charged chloride in the lumen. So to make lumen fluid, you know, electrically neutrally, means isoelectrical neutrality, to maintain isoelectric neutrality, the sodium also comes out. This is a positive ion in the lumen of the GI tract, but the sodium does not come through the apical membrane, it comes through the paracellular pathway. And when sodium comes, so along with sodium, it brings water also in the lumen, because to maintain the tonicity equilibrium, because now if more sodium comes, so the tonicity of the luminal fluid increase, so to maintain isotonicity, that it brings water along with it, but it happens through paracellular pathway. So this is how this chloride and sodium rich fluid is there, so they actually increases intestinal fluid secretion. This is, and because of that in extra fluid and all that, you know, there is stretch and distension of the intestine, there are stretch receptors, they are get activated, and they indirectly increase motility of the intestine, and that all leads to correction of the disorder for which they are being used. For example, that is being, it is to be used for chronic idiopathic constipation. Very commonly, it is a chronic idiopathic constipation. This has become so problematic that all these, you know, drugs are not able to treat that. And moreover, irritable bowel syndrome. Irritable bowel syndromes has two subtypes. That is the constipation dominant, and one is D. Diarrhea dominant. So it can be used, only approved for use in females more than 18 years of age, and in patient with opioid constipation. Opioid is a severe constipator, and if opioid cannot be avoided, suppose patient with cancer pain, or you know, such a condition where opioid analgesic has to be used and they are suffering from constipation, so this lubiprostone is an answer to those constipation. And the advantage is that if once you discontinue this drug, there is no rebound effect. Means there is no, you know, rebound constipation, or and constipation returns with vengeance. It's not like that. And there is no tolerance to its action. There is no tolerance. And, you know, there is no fluid, this electrolyte imbalance. And, you know, dependency is not there on these lubiprostones, that you become, because of no rebound effects. What happens when you stop it, there is the constipation comes back, then you again start using it, so it does not happen. So there is no dependency on its use. So people don't become dependent on Lubiprostone. So these are all desirable feature. No tolerance, no dependency, no electrolyte disturbances. So all these things are very important. Linaclotide, this is another new agent. These are having unique mechanism of action. Just see how do they act. It is a guanyl cyclase C agonist. Guanyl cyclase is an enzyme which act on, you know, GTP to form cyclic GMP. It is just like it, from ATP to cyclic AMP. So this, you know, this is indicated in adult for CIC. So this cyclic GMP and all that, that concentration increases in the mucosal cells of the, you know, intestinal wall, and that leads to secretion of the fluid and all that. Same, these are secretory agent, the increased secretion. You know, cholera also is a secretory diarrhea, is because of the activation of these pathways, cyclic AMP, cyclic GMP pathway. That is why watery evacuation is there in the cholera, and that is why cholera is very fatal kind of, you know, that can lead to dehydration within hours and can kill a patient or a person within hours. So this linaclotide is a guanylate cyclase C agonist, and it is used in CIC, chronic idiopathic constipation. And this needs to be taken empty stomach, and usually first meal of the day, that is the breakfast, 30 minutes prior. And you know, it is so potent, you know, in use in micrograms, can see. And there are two doses, 72 and 145 milligram strength, and that will depend upon the presentation of this patient, how difficult, I mean, this the intensity of the, or you know, severity of the chronic idiopathic constipation. So depending upon that, the dose may be selected, or may also be, if you, when you started with 145, depending upon the presentation of the patient, but patient is not tolerating, then you have to give it, you know, reduce the doses to half. So this is present in two strengths, not to be used in children, because they are so potent compound that can cause serious dehydration in children, to be avoided, right? So see, these drugs have unique mechanism of action, and the similar drug is the plicanatide, that is also a guanylate cyclase agonist and act in the same way. And this, you know, this has a metabolite, active metabolite also, and you know, through cyclic GMP increasing secretion of these, and because of these all that, and it is mainly through CFTR, because these all secretion. CFTR is what? Cystic fibrosis transmembrane regulator. This is an ion channels, chloride ion channels. So you know, so it acts mainly by the CFTR. So there is increased chloride rich fluid secretions and all that, and also it increases the secretion of the bicarbonate in the luminal fluid, and that causes, I think, you know, as I told you, that stretching of the intestinal wall, and that indirectly promotes peristalsis and all that. Not absorbed, that is very good, should not be absorbed, because we want local action, we don't want anything to be absorbed. These are the drugs which are meant to be used on at local. These are all local therapy kind of thing, you know. So it is used in IBS-C. This is, you know, constipation prone or dominant irritable bowel syndrome, CIC in adults, and dose is once daily, that is orally 3 milligram once daily. Eluxadoline, this is also a different, you know, kind of drug, and acts through a different mechanism of action, and it is indicated for in irritable bowel syndrome, which is diarrhea dominant. Now we will say, we are talking about constipation, and why, how come this is diarrhea dominant? Because, you know, this drug is something which can produce constipation, in fact, because it is used in IBS. So discontinue if severe constipation develops and that lasts for more than 4 days. So you should stop this eluxadoline, and it acts on opioid receptors. And you know, opioids are notorious for causing constipation. So why we are using this drug? What is the rationale behind all? I will be telling all this thing to you, because these opioid receptors, we have mu receptors, delta receptors, and kappa receptors. Opioid cause constipation because they cause, increases the muscle tone of the circular and longitudinal muscle of the intestine, because they inhibit the inhibitory interneurons. And second, they decreases the intestinal secretions. So they reduce the mortality and they decrease the secretion. So both things actually contribute to the constipation, the severe constipation produced by opiate compound. But this drug particularly have, you know, variety of effects. This is, you know, mu receptor agonist, kappa receptor agonist, but delta receptor antagonist. Whereas all receptors are involved in decreasing the motility as well as decreasing the secretion. So all are pro-constipatory. But one of this compound having delta receptor antagonist action. So there is some balanced action is there. So because of this agonist activity, it actually reduces the fluid secretion, gas formation and distension. That is important in to relieve the symptom of this IBSD. And it prevents constipation. It does not allow constipation to develop by this delta antagonist action. Okay, so that is why if somebody develops constipation, stop it. Otherwise, this molecule is meant with the intention that it should have a balanced activity, both relieving symptoms of the irritable bowel syndrome as well as reducing not allowing constipation to develop, despite knowing that these are the interacting with opioid receptors. So eluxadoline is very unique in this, right? Prucalopride, you know, pride, mosapride, etopride, cisapride, all these are prokinetic agent. I will be talking prokinetic in a separate class. So this prucalopride is a 5-HT4 receptor agonist. This 5-HT4 is involved in, you know, in increasing the motility of the, you know, intestine. And 5-HT3 receptors is inhibitory of the intestine. So we need something which can block 5-HT3 that will promote kinetic action, prokinetic action. And we also want dopamine, also is inhibitory. So we have something which is antagonist to dopamine receptor that will also act as prokinetic agent. So we have, because of this 5-HT4 receptor agonist, prucalopride is a gastrointestinal prokinetic agent, and that stimulates colon peristalsis by, you know, producing this term high amplitude propagating complexes. There are various migratory complexes in the, you know, smooth muscle cells of the intestine that decides peristalsis and all that. So this actually stimulate colonic peristalsis by action of this 5-HT4 receptors. They cause increase high amplitude propagating complexes, and that ultimately increase bowel motility. So this is also approved for chronic idiopathic constipation, CIC. So the CIC, you know, is a kind of situation where you exactly do not know why this constipation is occurring, and you know, so the treatment attempts are many, and you know, the scientists are involved in searching for any new target so that this problem, and this is, you know, constipation and diarrhea, we consider them as a very, you know, minor thing, but these problems are quite prevalent in the society, in the community, and that is why these problems require adequate solution in terms of effective therapy. So that was all about constipation. You could understand that constipation is not something which can be easily treated. And this chronic idiopathic constipation, you know, for that we had to find out drugs with unique mechanism of action, and still the quest is not over. People are trying to find out new targets, and lactitol, prucalopride, lubiprostone, and this plicanatide. All these are almost not very old compound. These are all, you know, are being tried. When we thought that simply laxatives or purgative will not act, so unique mechanism of action are being investigated and being tried, and new molecules are making it to market, and probably with the hope that this will take or means will fight with constipation and will and make a patient rid of such a complication or problems. Now we move to antidiarrheal drugs. This is a very good, you know, message. Please wash your hands unless you like diarrhea. So hand hygiene is very important in preventing waterborne diseases or anything fecal-oral route, the infection that is spread by fecal-oral route. So this is always a good practice to wash your hand more frequently. And nowadays, as you know, because of corona pandemic, this has become a practice, and this is good that is sensitizing us or preparing us for, you know, future problems. And probably in future, if we keep washing our hands and it becomes our habit, so we will be having less incidence of, you know, this fecal-oral infection transmission of certain diseases and decrease in incidence of those diseases. As I said, I start with this introduction of any topic so that you understand whenever I talk about the treatment of that particular situation or clinical condition, you should be able to understand that better. Usually any mild diarrhea will not cause dehydration as long as you have access to fluid, especially you can add that is rich in carbohydrate and electrolytes. So we can simply at home, we can add sugar or salt. We can simply take so mild diarrhea is not going to cause any dehydration if you are have access to fluid. But little more severe diarrhea, the oral rehydration, if you have your oral rehydration solution or salt, ORS is oral rehydrating salts, so you have to make it in a solution, and this contains all the ions that are required, this in the form of, we have glucose, sodium chloride, potassium chloride, sodium bicarbonate or sodium citrate. Now we have citrated ORS, and so this is preferred because it replenishes all the losses occurred during because of little more severe diarrhea. So it will replenish all this thing. But in severe diarrhea where, it is not possible to treat losses of water with the oral consumption, so then we need to give IV fluid, and the lactated Ringer or Ringer lactate is the fluid of choice and is to be given all severe hydration patient, dehydration patient. Many times such patients are not they can lose consciousness and all that, so it is difficult to give oral, so IV fluid becomes the they need to be hospitalized and needs to be given IV fluid. So let us talk about antidiarrheal agents. These antidiarrheal agents are usually used in mild to moderate diarrheal illnesses, and this can improve the comfort of the patient because nobody would like to go outdoor if he's having diarrheal episodes. Somebody is working, he would not like to go to the office because this is a real something embarrassing. So antidiarrheal agents are there to treat such infections, but these diarrheal episodes, should not be, these antidiarrheal agents are such which are used for functional diarrheas, not infective diarrheas, because in infective diarrhea you have to treat it with a specific antibacterial agent. So we firstly prefer opioid agents because opioid agents, as I said, are quite constipating. So these drugs actually reduce the number of stool frequency or decrease the stool frequency, make the stool more solid, means reduces the liquidity, and control fecal urgency as well. So this is what makes a person comfortable, because fecal urgency sometimes may be problematic. The you cannot have even opportunity to reach to the loo, and before that you get soiled. So this is important. So opioid agents is most important, which is used is loperamide. It comes as a Lomotil, and it is to be given as 4 milligram as first dose, and followed by 2 milligram after each motion. maximum you can give 8 milligram in a day. And as I said, the opioid agents produce constipation by causing or slowing the GI motility and GI secretions. So as I've already told you, so this loperamide also acts by this mechanism. And you know, because of these mu receptors and all these receptors, opioid receptors, causes inhibition of the inhibitory interneurons. So there is, you know, tonic, you know, muscle, increased tone of the muscles, circular as well as longitudinal. So it can cause abdominal cramp kind of things. But this loperamide is good in the sense that there is no tolerance to its constipation action, because this is opioid agent, and you know, there is no tolerance develops to the you know, meiosis tolerance and many, you know, effect of the opioid compound. So it works even if you use it for a long time. And the good thing is that this being, even it is an opioid compound, it is not absorbed after oral absorption. It is not absorbed after oral administration. Sorry, it should not be absorption, it should be administration. So it is good, it is not absorbed. Why? Because this is a substrate for P-glycoprotein. So P-glycoprotein, you know, P-glycoprotein, whatever comes inside, it will throw it out. So it does not, even if it is absorbed, it is in fact absorbed, but it is thrown out by the P-glycoprotein because it is a substrate for that. And that is the reason it cannot be abused even if taken parenterally, because P-glycoproteins are also, you know, expressed on blood-brain barrier. So the, you know, there is opioid compounds is abused because of their high or kick giving action. So if they cannot enter brain, they cannot produce this rewarding effect, or they cannot stimulate nucleus accumbens, or cannot produce dopamine release and all that. So it can't be abused even if you take it parenterally. So that is the reason. So that is why this loperamide is in the market. Otherwise, how an opioid compound is in the market and freely available? So because it cannot, you cannot enjoy its, you know, this pleasant effect or pleasurable effect that an opioid compound actually gives to a patient subject when it is abused. And but if you take certain other drugs with it, for example, if people know that P-glycoprotein inhibitors are used, for example, verapamil or quinidine, they can block P-glycoprotein activity, then it can be absorbed and can produce CNS action as well. Diphenoxylate is also similar to loperamide. It is also a compound, opioid compound, but in high doses, this compound produces typical opioid-like effect. But we usually don't use high doses. But if somebody knows that this is an opioid compound and he would like to misuse it, but this salt has very poor solubility. And for, you know, to have, you know, this pleasurable effect, one can inject it, because injectable, you know, opioid compound gives you a very rapid and high rush or kick. So because it is poorly soluble, it cannot be taken through injections. It will not be, you know, because it will block the syringe or needle. So it is not possible to make it dissolve this tablet in the water and take it through injections. So this is also not possible. So this is how, you know, misuse is avoided. But in oral tablet, as I said, if you take it in high dose, it can produce opioid like effect. So people would like to take too many of tablets of this drug, so the addicts would like to. But atropine sulfate is added to that, though in 100:1 ratio. But if somebody would like to overdose with this particular preparation, there will be highly noxious and non-pleasant effect, anticholinergic effect that will be, you know, exhibited because of the presence of atropine sulfate. So this prevent its misuse by the addicts and or subjects with unstable personality. Diphenoxine is nothing but the metabolite, active metabolite of the diphenoxylate, and which is 5 times more potent than the parent compound. This is also available in the fixed dose combination with atropine, so that it cannot be metabolized. The problem is these drugs are, you know, constipating agent actually. They act in functional diarrhea. If they are used in acute diarrhea and something, sometimes they can produce toxic megacolon. So that is a rare complication, and that it could be dangerous also many a time. Another compound which can be used in diarrheal illnesses, functional diarrhea, this bismuth subsalicylate. So this is helpful in traveler's diarrhea because subsalicylate, bismuth subsalicylate, we discussed already under the therapy against H. pylori in relation to the peptic ulcer diseases. So this bismuth subsalicylate is important or useful because it has antibacterial effect, and moreover it can also reduce this because of its antibacterial effect, and also reduces its vomiting viral enteritis. So viral enteritis will not be effective because it is having antibacterial effect, not the antiviral effect. So, but it reduces the vomiting, which is a common symptom of viral enteritis, gastroenteritis. So bismuth subsalicylate can be used in traveler's diarrhea, and this was the part of quadruple drug therapy in H. pylori because of its bacterial action. These are two antibiotics related to rifampicin, and these drugs, these antibiotics are very poorly absorbed from the GIT. So they are actually approved for traveler's diarrhea. One is rifaximin, another is rifamycin, but rifaximin have indications in addition to traveler's diarrhea, and traveler's diarrhea they are used for 2-3 days, and but not in cases where if you have fever or bloody diarrhea, it means it is infectious diarrhea and it needs specific antibiotic therapy. And so it is, these two antibiotics are just approved for non-invasive strain of E. coli, and if blood is coming in the stool, that means some invasive strain, maybe shigellosis or something like that, dysentery kind of thing. So for that you need different treatment. So that is, it is used for traveler's diarrhea caused by non-invasive strain of E. coli. Both the drugs can be used, but rifaximin is also available for use in IBSD. Okay. Because these drugs act by blocking the beta subunit of DNA dependent RNA polymerase, same as rifampicin. So they prevent RNA synthesis in the bacteria, and it is also used in hepatic encephalopathy to maintain the remission, because it doesn't because it act on the decrease the growth of the ammonia producing bacteria. Okay. And as I said, they work by stopping bacterial growth because they act on the this DNA dependent RNA polymerase, so prevent RNA synthesis. And azithromycin is also available for bacterial traveler's diarrhea, but it is can be taken as a 1 gram single dose or 500 milligram daily for 3 days. So these are the drugs which are to be used in traveler's diarrhea, and those were the drugs which used in functional diarrhea where do not have any infections, and they were acting just by producing constipation. One can choose empiric antibiotic therapy if there is diarrheal infection or diarrheal diseases in certain patients, but for acute community acquired diarrhea generally it is not indicated, because it is said that if it is acute community acquired diarrhea, they could be in viral in origin most of the time. So empiric antibiotic therapy may not be required. But the symptomatic inflammatory diarrhea even caused by invasive pathogen, they also resolve within days without antimicrobials. Even if you do not use any antimicrobials, they will also subside after a few days. Though they will have symptoms, but they will subside. But the body immunity will ultimately tackle that infection. But if you want to use antibiotics, there are empiric antibiotic therapy you want to use. You can use them for 1-3 days, and there are antibiotics like ciprofloxacin and ofloxacin and levofloxacin, and you can also use Bactrim-DS. Bactrim-DS is nothing, double strength. This is sulfmethoxazole and trimethoprim. Usually they are 400 milligram is sulfmethoxazole, 80 milligram trimethoprim, but this is you know, 960 milligram, 160 trimethoprim, 800 milligram sulfmethoxazole. So it is to be given twice daily, and the doxycycline 100 milligram tablet twice daily. So these antibiotics are available as empiric antibiotic therapy, and ultimately you can these are empirical antibiotic therapy. These are given on assumption that these particular you know, organism may be involved, but to be specific you should have, you know, culture sensitivity report, so that you can start a very narrow spectrum specific antibiotic for that particular infection. So this is how empiric antibiotic therapy has role in the treatment of diarrheal illnesses. So this is all which I have discussed under this constipation and diarrhea, and I hope that I have covered almost everything, every unique thing about any particular drug. I didn't miss anything, and if you, despite anything, despite all this, if you have any query, I am available on special, you know, platform Unacademy Special and special classes and Unacademy Plus also. As suppose I am today here, tomorrow I will be on Unacademy Special classes, but tomorrow I am not taking class. So, and day after tomorrow I will be on Plus. So I have three classes in a row, and it is alternated every third day. So I will be available on YouTube on 15th. Fine. Till then, if you wanna, you have any queries or anything, you can communicate to me on Unacademy Special classes, and for that, you know, you need to download that learning app, and you can ask your queries. And as earlier I have told that this is a group on the Telegram app. This will give you an idea also when who is available. Suppose you are interested in my class, you will get information from this group. So you just join this group on your Telegram app. You can watch me live on YouTube as you are watching today, and you can share this you know, information to others also, because you can make other also, you know, beneficiary of these free classes. So this is a kind of social service. You should do it, in fact. So by clicking this, you can directly reach to the YouTube's you know, platform NEET PG channel. So you can share this link to your friends and all that, and they can also enjoy, you know, these free classes who need it most. Maybe if you are not that much you know, interested, you can at least help others. And as I said, if you have any queries, you can come on, you know, special classes platform. There you can ask me, you can send me messages. If you follow me, then you can send me messages. I will be more than happy to answer those. So you definitely come on, you know, Unacademy Learning, download this learning app and come for special classes. And those special classes, because there is interaction, so they are very much like Plus platform. So you, if not have not downloaded this app till now, download it and install it, and just enjoy those you know, special classes. You will see the difference. And you just and if you want even more better, or in fact best of the services, then you can come on the Plus platform. This Plus has it means multiple services to offer, which you cannot get anywhere. But if you come on special classes, you will have little feel of Plus, how the Plus is, you know, the advanced version of, you know, kind of special classes. So I will be telling you what extra you get on special Plus. So I am available on Plus. There I am teaching endocrinology. On special classes, I am teaching respiratory, you know, system. So you can come with your queries from GIT to these special classes and attend those classes. If you think I can, you know, satisfy or answer your queries, or can take up your, you know, or dispel your doubts or confusion, so come on these free special classes. And if you are interested, if you want more, and then you can always subscribe to this Plus platform. And whenever you have decided to subscribe to Plus platform, always buy it for at least 12 months. Subscribe it for 12 months. Because the educators like me, there are many educators who can post their, you know, special courses on NEET PG, this plus platform, where you will have, you know, different kind of courses, different educators, so you will have opportunity to learn from different people, and that is always in your benefit. And if you really enjoying this, you can subscribe to this Academy Plus. And don't forget to use this my code. This is a referral code, which if you apply while buying subscription, you will get 10% discount. So don't forget this code, Dr. Pramod. And before leaving, I would say that you come on special classes platform, you will really find a difference. Here you cannot interact with me, but there you will be interacting with me, and I will be giving you, you know, immediate reply to your queries and all that, and that would be interactive. I can interact with you, you guys can interact with me, so that will be a more, you know, fruitful session and more interactive sessions. So that will keep you engaged. I will also feel happy. You will also feel happy getting your question answered, and I will be happy to answer your questions. Happiness is on the either side. You are enjoying getting answer to your questions. I am happy to give answer to your question. So not only that, you not only stay on this YouTube, NEET PG channel, you can very well come to an Academy special classes, and if you like, you can join an Academy Plus, but don't forget to use this, referral code Dr. Pramod, and enjoy 10% discount. And advantage, what I was saying on the Plus available is, it is more than the special classes, where you have interaction with the educators, your doubts, your queries, and they are answered right then and there. And if you buy one this subscription, you don't have to go anywhere. You have unlimited access to everything. You can download, you can watch offline, and you can this is one stop solution for everything. And there are also provisions for live polls, leaderboards. So this is a more interactive kind of, platform, where you actually enjoy. There are many test series, their analysis, you can take up as many as possible you like, and that will all enhance your knowledge, information, and will make you a better, learner. And moreover, this is everything is available offline, and there is live doubt clearing session, a special session after every three lessons which are taught on Plus platform. As I am teaching, endocrinology, I've just started, I have taken one lesson on that. So if you really want to enjoy, want to get taught by me, you can come on Plus platform. And this live doubt clearing sessions, after every three lessons, you have a special live doubt clearing session, and that will make you understand many things which you have not understood so far. So that is the advantage. And don't forget, you can always share this information with your friend, and I am sharing with you that I am teaching GIT on YouTube, I am teaching respiratory system on special classes, and I am teaching endocrinology on Plus platform. So you can enjoy, or you can find me anywhere, wherever you like, I will be there. So please join Plus. And other than that, give this information to your friend, and share this link and all that, this NEET PG channel. And if you found this lecture of mine is interesting and really informative, you can share this information or this link to this lecture link to your friends and all that. So just spread it to among those who need it most, who cannot afford to buy certain subscriptions, so they should get it free. So please do it in interest of the society. Just spread it. And if you like it, liked my presentation, you just like it, so that it gives me a moral boost kind of thing. And this bell icon is for you, that you get all the notifications which are available. You get all these notifications in time. So this was all about today's lesson. And I would request that I hope I would like to see you on all of you on Plus platform. If you're really enjoying my classes and you think that I can handle your, you know, and I'm giving you the best and I can handle your queries, solve your questions, I can dispel your confusions, I can remove your doubts, all that. So I'm just eagerly waiting for you guys to be on the Plus platform. If not Plus, you should be there on the special classes. Just give me a good like and share it with those who really need these informative lessons, and in that way you can do it, you can do a social service for others. So with this, I think the time is enough. I have taken too much of time, but this was important to explain you everything. And with this, I conclude my this presentation, and this is the time to say good night to all of you, and see you soon on the Plus platform or special classes, as I said that I am available there. Thank you. Thanks for patient listening. Bye bye.